I want you to look to the person to your left and look to the person to your right and say, all lives matter.
All lives matter.
I want you to look to the person to your left, look to the person to your right and say, all black lives matter.
All black lives matter. All lives matter.
Now I want you to do a round table. Give everyone a high five and say, what you do matters. This is really a time to think about some of the hard work that you're doing in your school districts around the state. The TACD, what you're going to cover from in a moment when you hear from Dr. Patrick Jean-Pierre, has been working with school districts around New York State for many years now, trying to address issues that we broadly define as issues related to racial disproportionality. Today's event focuses on discipline in particular. And anybody who's worked in schools knows that discipline is a central issue. Central to learning, central to teaching, central to school climate.
Because we know that everyone that is here today is here for a very important reason, and that is to create safe and caring schools. And as you move through the workshops today and you hear the keynote speakers, what we want to begin to help you to think about is how, not what we do to others when we think about discipline, but what we begin to do to ourselves. How do we begin to think differently about how we're supporting students and families so that we can assure that they're successful?
The work we dare to do is big, but we can do it. Together we can engineer a more equitable tomorrow. We can design architectures for increasing opportunity while reducing gaps between those who get pushed out of schools and those who are pushed to finish. Indeed, there is hope for thousands of young people in our gathering. So again, I welcome you, and I thank you for attending the 2015 TACD Summer Institute.
So in other words, Mr. Bashar and Ms. Charles will be taking a look at how they pulled in the students' prior knowledge to build those bridges between what they were learning about and some of the experiences that they have in their own lives. And this demands both that teachers know their students, that they know them well, and that they have the skills to transform what they know about the students into appropriate classroom practices. As this suggests, culturally responsive teaching is a profoundly adaptive and creative activity.
One of the tasks of culturally responsive teachers is to promote a classroom atmosphere that is conducive to conversation, both between students and the teacher, and among students themselves. That is basically the definition of Socratic Seminar. When we first brought up Socratic Seminar as being a culturally responsive method, there was a bit of a pushback. well, how is that relevant in our school? Basically, we just had to say, because we are meeting the kids where they are. We are letting them direct the instruction. They ask the questions, they answer the questions. When we first started doing this, we thought, okay, obviously, 7th, 8th grade, we're going to do this with our higher grade students. They are more developed, they have a lot more to say. But we also decided to bring in Ms. Charles in her kindergarten class. If you've ever been around more than two kindergartners, Ms. Charles has 28, then you know that they're always asking questions. They want to know more. They are sponges for information.
It's about love, I do know. A woman is fine and she can be fine. But a llama has no matter who knows.
Okay, so essentially there are four phases in what we did. And the very first phase is obviously studying a little bit about the Socratic seminar, the teaching strategies surrounding it. This is not a strategy that we currently had, or that we used in our school before. So something that we were open to, but something that we were a little reluctant to, only because of how unfamiliar we were with the strategy. And I know, speaking for myself, I love good classroom management, and so I felt like by employing this strategy and releasing basically all of the conversation over to the kids, that it would get a little bit out of control. Only because whenever you hand the power totally over to them, different things can happen. It's very up in the air. You don't know exactly what's going to happen. You don't know where the conversation is going to go. You don't know how one student is going to react to the comment that another student made. So I was a little apprehensive going into it. So that's a little bit about phase one. Phase two was actually designing the strategies. So after we left that day of phase one of studying the strategies, Ms. Charles and I actually went back to our classrooms, and a week later we came back with lesson plans. So then in phase three was the actual implementation of those strategies. So actually having the Socratic seminar with the students. So that's essentially the largest part of the video that you're going to see, is the kids actually doing it. And then phase four was a debrief of the video. We talked about what we thought went well and then what we would do differently.
Just keep in mind that we didn't have a trial run. We didn't do like a prepping and then, you know, then the videotaping. We did the videotaping that day and it was all done for the first time. And it was a new experience for our kids, our students, and definitely for the teachers, because now we were moving from teacher-centered direct lessons to kids' direct lessons, so where they had to pose the questions, so where they had to carry the conversation where they wanted it to go.
But a llama has no matter who.
They turn green and all the friends turn different colors.
Why did all the parents and the kid talk?
I wonder why they were running under tunnels.
I didn't know why they hugged and then they turned together green.
Yellow and blue make green.
What makes a friend?
I think my friend is Alina.
What makes Alina your friend?
I come to her house and she let me play with her house and her toy and we can make some ice cream.
Sometimes my cousin comes over to my house. Sometimes I go to over his house. So maybe they can do that too.
Okay. And is your cousin your friend?
No, but he's only my cousin.
He's your cousin, but not your friend. Well, can your cousin be your friend?
Sometimes people could mix up, and sometimes they could be your friend too. Sometimes they could be your cousin or your friend.
Do you have to be one way?
No.
And be a friend?
It could be different ways.
You could be friends with liking the same thing or not liking the same thing.
It could be in any way you want.
I thought it would be something interesting to expose them to at this early point in their education. And going forward, if our school really adapted, it would be something that they would really flourish in doing. And it would become a really vital part of their education. So I was up to the challenge.
Yeah.
Mr. Fulham came to our school to look at our PBIS program and see the way that our ticket economy was working and what we were doing with students. And we had a student or two that had painted Converse on, and we talked about how we might replicate that as an incentive.
You make something big.
We just talked about all of our incentives this year for middle schoolers and how we created an economy for middle schoolers, which was much different from the past because middle schoolers never really had any middle school options. What they do is they throw the tickets on the floor, they would think they were worthless, but because we've had so many great field trips and places to go, and we have a recreation room they can buy into, it's been a very positive change this year.
In a juvenile court so you can see our babies going through the system, see them in their jumpsuits, see them young, innocent children. You need to go sit in the court so that you understand the ramifications of the decisions that we make. This young man is sitting in court and I'm watching the judge look at different kids different ways. A young white man comes before him, a student teenager, and he says to the young man, "So, what are your plans? What are your plans for life?" The young man says, "Oh, I think I want to go to college, blah, blah, blah." He gets some, you know, nice, easy probation. Don't do it again. Write a letter of apology. Another young black male goes in front of him, "So, what are your plans in life?" The young man says, "Well, I don't really know." Oh, he gets the book thrown at him. Because someone is making a decision about the value of that life. And too often, when we're in schools, we're not thinking about what's down the road when we make that one decision, how it can change the trajectory of a child's life. We know that suspensions don't work. Doesn't work, and in fact, they hurt.
Where teachers facilitate what they call community building circles. So again, that's your typical morning meeting. It's your circle up. Let's face each other. Let's use a talking piece so everyone has an opportunity to have their voice heard. Let's have frank and open discussions about relevant issues in the community or in their lives. At tier two, they have more mediations. At tier three, there's more structured restorative conferencing. So you're going to see this kind of theme of this continuum of practices. They also have something called responsive circles. So I just want to share that with you. They also use the community building circles, which they call proactive circles. But responsive circles are, if you're in your classroom, there's a classroom management issue or conflict between peers, you might stop everything, even because things are disrupted already. You circle everyone up and you problem solve around, this just happened in our room. What's our solution? We have these agreements in this room. They were breached. Let's figure out how we can repair the harm and acknowledge what's going on. And then finally, the formal conferences are for folks who engage in more serious infractions. The goal here is to develop joint solutions to repair the harm. And I want to say something twice. Accountability for wrongdoing is central to the conferences. I'm going to say that again. A lot of people think, well, it just means they're getting off easy because they're not getting suspended. And I would beg to differ here. When you have to face who you've harmed and the consequences of action, it can be a very profound experience. Another piece of this is the aim is to reintegrate the wrongdoer back into community. So it's moving away from pushing out and exclusion into bringing back and teaching through discipline processes. A hallmark of restorative approaches are using these questions. And many of you have seen these before. What strike, these are supposed to be infused in interactions through the whole school day. These are supposed to be in posters. The idea that students in early are using them themselves. The idea is really to infuse this way of problem solving. What happened? How are you affected? What do you do to make things right? For the person who was harmed, what did you realize? What did you think when you realized what had happened? How has this affected you and others? What do you think needs to happen to make things right. So the integration of the victim and their perspective is also key here. So what does a highly restorative classroom look like? So in some of the research I've done, students would answer affirmatively to these following statements. There's respect when it comes to talking about feelings. There's restorative questions that are being used. There's proactive community building circles. So in a small scale study, I found that high RP classrooms had a narrow racial discipline gap. So let me unpack this for a second. These are classrooms where students answered affirmatively to all those questions I just listed. And those teachers had much similar rates of referral for misconduct defiance referrals for Latino students and for African American students relative to white and Asian students. I have not seen any systematic data to show schools implementing restorative practices are running amok. You know, that something is not working and everything is falling apart, you know, despite some press that we've heard about that. In a recent evaluation in Oakland that I mentioned, teachers, and this is really important, teachers say their school climate has improved, RP is, they feel, has built caring adult-student relationships and strengthened students' conflict resolution skills. And that really matters, right? Teachers' perceptions, right? They don't feel like their whole world is falling apart with this. In fact, they think it's really helping the schools. And on top of that, reading proficiency has increased in RJ schools in Oakland, attendance rates have increased, and rates of graduation. So this is all really exciting.
Will look like today, but together we can begin to imagine what it will look like. As the American computer scientist Alan Kay said, the best way to predict tomorrow is to invent tomorrow today. We join together to undertake no small task.
The ELL students, they're always in the background. They're always the ones that are not saying anything. They're always the ones that are the quiet ones in the class. It gives them a chance to come forward and share. And you saw a couple of my ELLs in there talking, you know, and it doesn't matter how long it takes them to get it together, how long it takes them to get the English words out, I'll wait. You know, and I've trained my kids, everyone has to have their thoughts and their opinions heard.
I think it's very important that student voice is essential in this process. As today you'll see, there'll be many students roaming around. And that's because we really believe that students are critical. Enough to simply say, don't suspend. Suspension should be seen as the last resort, not the only resort. But what we really got to get focused back on is how do we expand the opportunity to learn for more children?